confirm before we open the floor to questions. It's interesting, it's a winter movie on top of everything else, kind of appropriate in the sense it looks really cold in there. Can you describe a little bit how you prepared for this movie and how you came across the script? It's an independent film, it's been reviewed as quite against type, and I think a lot of you are familiar with Ms. Han Ji-min's work on TV as well. So I want to ask you about how you prepared for this and how you came across the script.
네, 그 첫 번째 질문은 그 이 배역을 위해서 어떻게 준비를 하셨는지 그리고 두 번째는 이 배역 아 이 대본을 어떻게 받아보게 됐는지 궁금하다고 합니다.
일단 대본을 어떻게 받았는지는 사실 미스백 대본이 많은 배우들한테 돌진 않았었는데요. 어느 날 제가 해외 일정을 마치고 돌아가서 좀 잠이 안 왔을 때였어요. 한 새벽 4시 정도에 잠이 안 들어서 그냥 꺼내서 시나리오를 읽었었는데 물론 4시가 감성적인 시간이긴 하잖아요. 그 시간에 이제 대본을 꺼내 봤는데 다른 작품은 어떤 시나리오를 접하는 느낌이었다면 이거는 실화를 바탕으로 했기도 했고 항상 뉴스에서 접했던 아동학대 뉴스가 많았기 때문에 어떤 정말 끔찍한 그 현장을 목격한 기분이 들었었어요. 그래서 저에게는 어떻게 보면 새로운 도전이나 변신이 될 수 있는 작품이었었겠지만 그런 목적보다는 아동학대라는 사회적 문제를 다룬 영화를 많은 분들께서 접하시고 조금은 다른 시각으로 더 깊게 이 문제를 인지하셨으면 좋겠다라는 그런 마음으로 선택을 하게 되었었습니다.
So I would say the script for Miss Beck didn't circulate among like many actresses, I would say. I remember I came back from a foreign schedule that I had abroad and I was back home. It was around 4 in the morning when I picked up the script for Miss Beck. And as you all know, around like 4 a.m. in the morning, we all have our emotional sides. We're more in touch with our emotional sides. And when I read it, it struck me not like a film script, but more so because it was based on a true story and it was dealing with child abuse issues that is quite an issue in Korea as well. It felt to me as if I was witnessing a true incident rather than reading a film script. And so for some actresses, I think some actresses would have jumped at the idea to sort of do like a radical character change and to showcase their range and skill. But for me, rather than focus on that part of the job, for me it was important for me to spread the word and shed light on these child abuse issues. And hopefully, as audiences saw the film, to bring about a deeper understanding of this issue that is quite prevalent than we think it might be.
지금 생각났는데 처음 시나리오 받았을 때가 뉴욕의 밀정이라는 영화로 제가 한번 인사를 드리러 온 적이 있었어요. 뉴욕에서 돌아가서 처음 읽었던 시나리오였었어요. 근데 밀정이라는 작품으로 이렇게 해외에도 한국분들이나 외국 관객분들을 만나게 돼서 저에겐 배우로서 굉장히 새로운 경험이었었고 언젠가 저의 또 다른 영화로 꼭 와보고 싶다라는 바람을 가졌었는데 신기하게도 처음 읽었던 시나리오 또 다시 오게 됐네요. 여담이지만.
This is, I guess, a little side story, but I just remembered this script, the script for Miss Beck, was the script I read right after being here, actually, in New York 2.5 years ago for another movie directed by director Kim Ji-hoon called Age of Shadows. And I was really struck by that experience because I was meeting a lot of Korean audiences here in New York, and I was very touched by their response. So I had thought that I wanted to meet more Korean audiences and more international audiences here in New York. And here I am again with Miss Beck in New York. So it's really remarkable.
So you were attracted primarily by the social aspect of the film rather than the character itself. But I want to ask you what you thought about the character and also how you feel about the social issues in general. It's a big part of your life also, aside from being an actress. So I want to ask you about that as well.
Social issues in general. 어떤 사회적인 이슈에 대한 어떤 그 대화의 장을 마련하고 싶어서 이 배역을 선택했다고 하는데요. 그렇지만 이제 백상화라는 캐릭터에 대해서는 또 어떤 방식으로 접근을 했는지 그리고 사회적 이슈에 대한 이제 배우님의 그 관심이 굉장히 깊은 걸로 알고 있는데 어떤 사회적 이슈에 대한 배우님의 시각이랄까? 네, 그런 건데. 네.
일단 그 백상아라는 캐릭터는 기존에 제가 맡았던 캐릭터랑 굉장히 좀 차별점이 많이 있었어요. 그리고 아무래도 제가 한 번도 경험해 보거나 느껴보지 못한 감정들을 다 담고 있어야 되는 캐릭터였었기 때문에 그 캐릭터에 대해서 접근을 하고 구축해 나가는데 가장 어려웠던 작품이기도 했었어요. 그리고 궁극적으로는 제가 갖고 있었던 기존의 저란 배우에 대해서 많은 분들이 생각하는 그 이미지가 있었기 때문에 이 영화에 대한 본연의 진심을 잘 전달하기 위해서는 온전히 저의 이미지를 다 버리고 백상아였어야만 했었던 것 같아요. 그래서 가장 심혈을 기울여서 작업을 했던 부분은 오히려 시나리오에 표현되지 않았던 백상아의 과거의 이야기였던 것 같아요. 그 아이가 어렸을 때 학대를 당하고 자라고 전과자가 되고 감옥에 갔다 나와서 시나리오에 없었던 부분까지도 감독님이랑 뭐 이희준 배우랑 계속 얘기를 하면서 상아한테 접근해 가는 걸 가장 열심히 준비를 했었고요. 그리고 사회적 문제에 대한 부분 여기까지 먼저 할까요? 네.
So preparing for the role of the character of Pixella, definitely it was very different from all the characters that I've previously played as an actor. Especially because I had to portray emotions and experiences that I myself have not experienced firsthand, and so that was probably the most difficult part for me. I also had to sort of deal with the preconceived notions that a lot of Korean audiences have about me as an actor, and so when I was preparing for this role, I really felt that in order to really communicate the heart of this film, I would really have to throw away what I had been conceived as an actress and to really embody and become the role of Pixella. So to tell you a little bit about the preparation, I think the most important part that I focused on was to really build her history and backstory and her lived through experiences that are not necessarily really in the script. For instance, how her trauma from sexual abuse, and her going to jail, and just really trying to build the foundation of her lived experiences. I think that's what I really focused on the most.
그래서 상하라면 어떤 행동을 할 때 이렇게 할까 아니면 대사 톤을 억지로 좀 세게 보여야 된다거나 이렇게 외형적으로 다가가기보다는 그 상하의 과거를 쌓는데 한 3개월 정도 그런 작업을 했었던 것 같고 그게 쌓이다 보니까 자연스럽게 상하라면 이렇게 할 것 같다라는 게 좀 많이 쌓였던 것 같아요. 그리고 네 여기까지 먼저.
When thinking about Sangha's character, I would think, oh, how would she behave in this situation? So rather than approaching it from the outside in, for example, like, you know, would she talk this way or would she just talk in a very aggressive sort of way, rather than starting from like an outer characteristic, like I said, because I was starting from the inside out, building her history, I think from that I was able to, as an actor, I was getting more inspirations on how she would naturally feel and behave from that history that I was building. I spent about 3 months really building that history and backstory of my character, and I think that's what really led to a more natural portrayal of her.
네, 그리고 이제 사회적 문제에 대한 부분은 배우라는 타이틀로 대중들에게 영향을 끼칠 수 있는 그런 힘에 대해서 항상 고민을 많이 하거든요. 근데 이런 이슈들을 가지고 많은 분들이 가슴 아파하고 안타까워하는 부분은 다 있지만 이게 어떤 매체를 통해서 보여지느냐에 따라서 또 받아들여지는 부분이 다르다고 항상 생각을 하고 있어요. 그래서 뭔가 배우라는 타이틀로 어떠한 영향력을 끼칠 수 있을까라는 거를 늘 고민을 하는데 그게 작품으로 보여지게 될 때가 가장 사실 좀 뿌듯하기도 하고 가장 큰 힘이 있다고 생각이 들어요. 그래서 아동학대라는 문제를 누구나 다 인지는 하고 있지만 영화라는 장르를 통해 보여진다면 관객분들께 좀 더 감정적으로 깊게 다가갈 수 있지 않을까라는 생각으로 꼭 이런 영화는 영화화시키고 싶었었고요. 그런 마음으로 사실 모든 스태프분들도 본인들의 막 개런티를 다 낮춰서까지 이 작품을 꼭 만들고 싶어 했었던 것 같아요. 그리고 아무래도 이런 장르는 영화 시장에서 환영받지 못하지만 영화가 한국에서 개봉했을 때 저예산 영화임에도 불구하고 많은 분들이 이제는 힘을 많이 실어주시더라고요. 그래서 진짜 오랜 시간 상영할 수 있게 많이 도와주셨어요. 그래서 그런 힘들이 모여서 작겠지만 앞으로 더 Sorry, too long. okay. 우리 미래가 바뀌지 않을까란 그런 희망으로 작업을 했습니다. 끝.
touching on a second, so I can do this. as an actor and consequently as a public figure, I always think about what I can. Do in order to sort of bring about change or a change in perception, if you will. I think the issue of child abuse, a lot of people think about it and a lot of people worry about it, I'm sure, but I think there's a lot that can be done by the portrayal of this issue through the media. Namely, in this case, through film. And when I ponder the question of what my role is as a public figure in this sort of landscape of a lot of social issues that are going around in society, I think it's best when that change or that the message can be shown through my work. So, for example, in this case, the child abuse issue is dealt with through the medium of film. And for me, I feel like that's sometimes a more effective way to really touch people's hearts and to get people to think, rally people to think more deeply about that issue. I think not only this just wasn't my own thoughts, but I feel like everyone who was involved in the making of this film really felt the same way, so much so that our cast and crew, they would lower their quotes to really get this film made, because as you know, it wasn't, it was a low budget film. But we were all as one, we really wanted to get it made. And after it was made and after it was shown in theaters, I was really, really surprised and touched to see a lot of audience members coming out to support the film as well as help little by little to spread the word. So in this way, I feel like even though it's a very small steps sometimes, I feel that those small steps can lead to hopefully a bigger change and a bigger change for the better.
Thank you.
You should probably point out that the film came out at the same time as A Star Is Born in Korea. It did actually a lot better. I think it came out 2 or 3 days afterwards. It came out at the same time as Burning. It also, Bae Yi Chang Dong also did a lot better. So it was quite a commercial success, actually. I want to ask you if you had any concerns tackling that part, because there's a lot of cursing in the film. Perhaps here in the US, we're a lot more used to cursing, swear words. It's quite common. It's a little bit more, can be a little bit more of an issue, I guess, in Korea, in the sense it's a very image-oriented business. So did you have any concerns tackling that and the cursing, yes?
네, 뭐, 네, 막 욕도 많이 나오고 또 이제 그 배역 자체에 대한 걱정은 없었는지 이제 미국 같은 경우에는 사실 욕설하는 거에 대해서는 한국에 비해서는 좀 덜 이제 심각하게 생각하는 부분도 있고, 근데 아무래도 한국 영화 산업상 이제 이미지가 또 중요하다 보니 이제 그런 배역을 맡는 거에 대한 특별한 두려움이나 걱정은 없었는지.
이 캐릭터로 대중분들께 어떠한 이미지로 받아들여질까라는 고민은 전혀 없었고요. 오히려 이제 상아라는 인물이 비록 어른이지만 보호받지 못한 채 자란 어린아이의 형태를 지닌 사람이라고 생각을 했었어요. 그래서 작지만 사실 세상에 대한 그런 반항을 갖고 있는 캐릭터였기 때문에 일부러 강한 립스틱도 바르고 이렇게 노랗게 탈색한 머리를 하면서 거친 말들을 하는 게 상아는 자기를 보호하고자 했던 마음이라고 생각이 들었었거든요. 일단 여기까지 할까요? 네.
I will have to say that I really didn't think too much about how I would be received image-wise when I was taking upon this role. More so I was really focused on how I was really going to truthfully portray the role of Pik Sang-a. She is an adult in the film, obviously, but emotionally, I feel that she's still, in a sense, in a childlike stage emotionally for her. She's really fighting against this world that surrounds her to survive because she's experienced such great trauma in her life. So as you see in the film, she's bleached her hair and, you know, she has really thick, really like bright red lipstick on her. When you really think about it, I think those things are actually working as a mechanism of self-defense.
한국 영화에서 물론 욕도 많이 하고 담배 피는 그런 캐릭터들도 많았는데 어떠한 배우가 하느냐에 따라서 그런 관심도가 굉장히 다르더라고요. 그래서 이제 기존에 제가 갖고 있었던 아무래도 다른 캐릭터로 쌓여졌던 이미지가 있다 보니까 처음에는 이제 영화를 선보이고 나서 모든 포커스가 담배를 언제부터 폈을까, 과연 지금은 끊었나, 계속 피나, 이런 점에 굉장히 주목을 많이 하시더라고요, 미디어에서. 사실 예상했던 반응이긴 했었는데 그 점이 조금 안타까웠지만 제가 오히려 걱정했던 부분은 백상아로서 어떠한 작은 제스처가 조금이라도 부자연스러우면 관객분들이 영화에 몰입이 되는데 굉장히 방해가 될 것 같은 게 가장 큰 걱정이었어요. 그래서 작은 행동이나 담배 필 때 침을 뱉는 그 작은 모션까지도 많은 부분 연구를 하고 노력을 했었습니다.
I mean, I will say, like in Korean films, there is quite a lot of cursing and smoking going on. But in my experience, I feel that depending on which actor is doing the smoking and cursing, the response can be wildly different depending on the actor. And so when this film first came out in the theaters, yes, some of the focus was really on, oh my God, when did she start smoking? Is she still smoking? Is this still going on? How did she do that? That kind of response I did anticipate. But for me, I think what I was really concerned about was I felt that if any kind of gesture that the character of Pik Sang-a made, if that came across in any way unnatural or contrived, that would really prohibit audiences from really getting lost in the film and the human being that is Pik Sang-a. So for me, rather than really focusing on the audience's reaction on the smoking or cursing, it was just for me it was about really mastering those small gestures so that they would come across as a complete part of who Pik Sang-a is as a person. So I really put I remember really putting a lot of thought into just the smallest gestures as well.
Thank you. I have more questions, but I think we should open the floor to questions now to the audience. I'm sure you guys have some questions. Yes, the gentleman, can we bring microphones out around here? Yeah, the gentleman right here. Just the microphone is coming.
Hello, I'm Should I speak in English or?
Let's do it in English.
English, no. Actually?
We're in New York.
Okay. Hello guys, my name is Edward. 제 한국 이름은 my current name is 태초에. 네, 태초에 창세기 1장 1절에 있는 이름입니다.
반갑습니다. Nice to meet you.
I was very struck by your performance. It was very touching and at the same time it was very beautiful. 상당히
fine.
감동적이었고
상당히 Mr. Translate.
I'm currently 약간 어색하네요. 같이 하려니까 I'm currently studying at Columbia University. And I'm taking this university writing class. Human rights. 저는 지금 콜롬비아 대학교에서 공부하고 있는데
other than
just a writing essay, you've seen a huge desire for from this audience that we would like to, you know, contribute or help in this issue. Other than writing a check, what are some ways that we can help solving this problem?
지금 콜롬비아 대해서 인권
태초의 실 네.
인권 강의를 듣고 있는데요. 어떤 기부금이나 후원금을 통해서가 아닌 이 영화를 본 저희 관객이 관객으로서 혹은 개인으로서 이런 이제 아동학대 이슈나 이런 사회적 이슈에 보탬이 될 수 있는 방법이 있다면은 뭐가 있다고 생각하시는지.
사회적 이슈에 대한 그런 마음을 내는 방법은 여러 가지가 있다고 생각이 들어요, 항상. 근데 이제 아동학대에 대한 부분은 제가 이제 미스백을 통해서 한국에서 아동학대 예방 홍보대사를 하고 있거든요. 근데 사실 가장 무서운 것은 그 아이들에게는 무관심인 것 같아요. 그러니까 저희가 그냥 이렇게 흔히 우리가 바빠서 지나칠 수 있는 부분, 그리고 내가 귀찮아질까봐 이 관계가 얽히면 더 복잡해질까봐 그래서 내 아이가 아니라는 마음으로 이렇게 모른 척할 때가 굉장히 많거든요. 그리고 그렇기 때문에 그 아이들에게는 관심이 가장 중요한 부분이고 지은이 같은 아이를 봤을 때는 사실 물론 제도적인 측면에서 어떤 증거나 증명할 수 있는 부분이 굉장히 필요한 부분이 있긴 하지만 영화에서도 보셨듯이 경찰서에서 아이가 아니라고 하면 이렇게 데려가기가 쉽지 않은 부분이 많아요. 그래서 뭔가 이제 증인이 될 수도 있거나 그런 관심적인 부분이 가장 중요한 것 같고요. 다른 부분에 있어서는 사실 여러 가지 방법이 있는 것 같아요. 도네이션에 관한 부분은 사실 저도 1년에 한 번, 두 번 정도 먼저 이거 할까요? 네.
I think there are various ways that we can all get involved in solving social issues. To be more specific on the issue of child abuse, I'm currently an ambassador in Korea for child abuse prevention, which is my way of contributing. Learning more about this issue, for me, I feel like the biggest enemy in solving this kind of issue is indifference. Because we all lead busy lives and, you know, some people think it's too much of a hassle to get involved and, you know, we all think, oh, but this isn't my kid, blah, blah, blah. But that indifference is what is really harmful to the kids who are struggling and being victimized. So I think one really easy thing is to really pay attention and to really give this issue the attention that it deserves. Also, I guess to speak from a more, legal or institutional standpoint, it's important to have a lot of evidence against people who perpetrate this kind of violence and abuse. As you have seen in the film, there is a scene where she Ji-eun goes to the police station. But right now in Korea, at least, if the child denies that it ever happened, it's really difficult for them to press charges against the parents. So in that vein, maybe if you've witnessed this kind of abuse, you can come out as a witness to supply evidence. But I would say the biggest thing would be to, in that vein, pay attention and try to help out.
Thank you. Let's take another question from Wu. Okay, not sure we're going to be able to do the gentleman over there. Yeah, with your.
Thank you. Yeah. Hi. Yeah.
There's a mic.
Thank you. Yeah. Hi. My question is about the child actress who did a great job. And I just want to know how she was handled or taken care of during some of the more difficult scenes, if she was, you know, if she were affected by it in between the takes.
Okay, good question. 네, 아역 배우 김 시아에 대해서 질문인데요. 감정적으로 특히 어려운 부분에서는 어떤 방식으로 촬영을 했고 이제 보호가 잘 됐는지 특히 뭐 이제 테이크 중간 중간에도 어떻게 했는지.
그러니까 시아양 같은 경우는 캐스팅에서 있어서 한 번도 얼굴이 보여지지 않은 배우를 하길 원했었어요. 그리고 정말 물론 그 시아양도 예쁘지만 조금 이렇게 사람들이 지나쳤을 때 정말 옆집에 살고 있을 법한 그런 아이를 찾고 싶어 하셨었거든요. 그래서 시아양 같은 경우는 이 미스백의 연기가 첫 연기였었어요. 그래서 무엇보다도 아직 연기를 어떻게 해야 되는지 모르는 아이이기도 했고 저희가 이제 영화 촬영 들어가기 전에 가장 중요하게 생각했던 부분도 시야를 지켜주는 일이었었어요. 그래서 상담사가 항상 시야랑 이야기를 나누고 저희 전체 스태프분들에게 가장 중요하게 말씀해 주셨던 부분도 지은이랑 시아를 늘 분리시켜서 대해주는 방법이 있었어요. 그래서 항상 촬영장에서도 시아를 부를 때 지은이로 부르지 않고 시아로 꼭 불러줘야 됐었고 그리고 어려운 신이나 감정들에 대해서는 감독님이랑 시아가 얘기를 많이 나누면서 신별로 이제 시아 양이 다 지은의 감정으로 일기도 다 쓰고 아까 제가 한 3개월 정도 그런 작업을 했듯이 시양도 지은이의 감정을 이해하기까지 이야기를 많이 나눴었던 것 같아요. 그래서 막상 현장에서는 시양이 굉장히 톡톡하기도 했고 어른스러워서 NG 없이 연기를 많이 잘 해주셨었고 실제로 촬영 끝나고 시아양을 보듬어 주는 데 있어서 모든 스태프들이 그거를 되게 중요하게 다뤘던 것 같아요.
So with this film, the director wanted an unknown child actor, and she really wanted to find someone who you would think would be like a girl next door. So this was Xia's first project as an actor, and because of that, everyone on set thought the most important thing was to really protect her and make sure that she was not getting hurt through the process of filmmaking. In order to ensure that we had a counselor that worked with her at all times, on set and off set, and the counselor told everyone, the cast and crew, that it was really important to separate the identities of the character of Ji-eun and then the actress Xia. So we were instructed to refer to her as Xia in between takes, so that identity would not confuse her, that she would really be able to readily separate herself from her character Ji-eun. When it came to the more difficult scenes, the director and Xia would have a lot of conversations about Ji-eun as a character, and she actually did a lot of prep work herself, journaling as the character of Ji-eun and you know, writing about her day and her daily goings on. So actually, because we had done so much of that prep work beforehand, on set she was very grown up. I don't remember any bad takes from her, and we were able to very successfully film it with not much trouble.
Thank you. I'm being discreetly told that there's no more time for questions, but we're gonna take one last question just because we don't have Miss Han very often. Okay, fine. Alright, can someone give her a microphone? The lady in the front, second row.
So it was very impressive to see the fighting scene between you, between Sang-ha and
Mi-kyung.
Was it like completely choreographed or was it really spontaneous? And also, if Jang-seop didn't show up, do you think Sang-ha will eventually kill her at the end?
Interesting.
Wait, kill Jang-seop?
미경 역했던 배우와 저는 유튜브에서 되게 많이 찾아봤어요. 실제 싸움 영상 이렇게 했는데 근데 정말 과격하고 폭력적인 거예요. 근데 이제 촬영에서 감독님께서 진짜 원하셨던 거는 짜여지지 않은 그런 액션이었거든요. 그래서 처음에는 막무가내로 진짜 싸웠어요. 근데 이게 이제 연기다 보니까 마구 때릴 순 없잖아요. 그러다 보니까 머리를 잡고 밀치고 넘어지고 계속 이런 것만 하다 보니 카메라에 담기가 너무 어렵더라고요. 그래서 그 다음번에 이제 큰 샷 같은 거는 따로 이제 액션 감독님이랑 이제 짜서 만들어진 거고 최대한 그 한국 표현으로 날 것 같은 싸움을 하고자 노력을 했었고요. 일단 여기까지 할까요?
So we prepared this fight scene for quite some time. I believe we shot that scene for about 3 days. When I was trying to prepare for this, I realized that there's not many films that depict women like fighting like that. So I actually went on YouTube with the person who played Mi-kyung to actually like look for actual fights between women, and I was really surprised to see that they were actually very violent and aggressive. Our director didn't want it to look too choreographed, so when we first started out trying to film that scene, we were just, you know, going at each other, trying to just go at each other, but there's just so much you can do with like hair pulling and just, you know, hitting someone, and like when you actually just try to do it spontaneously, it sometimes doesn't read, or you can't sometimes actually capture that as well as you want on film. So I remember, especially for like the master shots, we choreographed a little bit of that, and then getting into more close-up shots, we were trying to capture the bit of more spontaneity in the fight scenes.
그리고 저도 감독님께 질문을 했었어요. 장섭이가 나타나지 않으면 정말 상하는 미경이를 죽이려고 했을까요에 대해서. 근데 이제 둘이 싸우다가 딱 지쳐 쓰러져서 제가 딱 눈을 떠서 그걸 캐치하셨는지 모르겠지만 미경이의 약간의 떨림이 있어요. 그걸 보고서 이제 상하는 정말 이렇게 표하듯이 괴성을 지르잖아요. 그게 그때 결심을 하게 되는 것 같아요. 정말 나는 지은이를 차에 두고 그 사람 지은이를 떠나서 그 미경이한테 가서 묻잖아요. 정말 죽일 생각이었냐고. 그때 미경이 대답을 듣고 나서는 죽이려고 했었던 것 같아요. 그리고 나서 이 싸움 그때 쓰러졌는데 미경이가 아직도 살아서 꿈틀거리는 그 모습이 어떻게 보면 내 인생의 끝이 왜 이렇게 됐을까, 어디부터 잘못했을까, 이런 것들이 굉장히 복합적으로 올라오면서 이제 끝을 내야겠다라는 마음으로 사실 돌을 든 거긴 했었어요. 네. 장섭이 오지 않았다면 내리쳤을 것 같아요.
I actually had a conversation with my director about if Jang-seop hadn't showed up, would Sang-ha really try to kill Migyeong. And when you, if you remember from that scene, I don't know if you remember, but like there was a little tremble in Migyeong's eyes. And Sangha herself, she really demands to Migyeong, like she asks her, like, did you really mean to kill Jiyun? And she when she hears the answer, I think that Sangha really did mean to kill her. And when she, even after going through that fight and then she sees like Migyeong crawling for dear life on the floor, I think a lot of emotions welled up in her, just thinking about her life too and just how much that she's gone through. And I feel like that sort of emotion really just sort of had an explosion in her. And I feel that she was really intending to put an end to it all by killing Migyeong. So I think so, yeah, if Jeong-seop had not come to put a stop to it, I really do think she would have put a stone to Migyeong's head.
Thank you very much for your very detailed